Japanese imperialism, although a major influence in Japan's history of economic and governmental development, has caused major bloodshed, death, and suffering on a massive scale, which not only affected Japan's inhabitants throughout the countries of imperialism, but also several warring countries who were either allies or enemies to Japan. This mockumentary will go through the changes Japan made as a country, why and how Japan's eventual corruption negatively affected itself and other countries, and the reformation of the imperial government into a parliamentary democracy.
The Edo or Tokugawa period, which lasted from 1603 to 1867, will be the final era of traditional Japanese government and culture before the Meiji Restoration, which eventually propelled the country into a modern generation, under the rule of the Tokugawa shogunate, or the hereditary military dictatorship. Edo Japan maintained relative peace. The shogunate military leaders were legally under the rule of the emperor, but as Japan grew into a feudal society, control of the military became relative to control of the country. The emperor was a symbolic figurehead of reassurance, with no real power or purpose. Japan during the Edo period was also ruled by 300 daimyo, or feudal lords, who each governed different regions inside the country. Think of Japan's segregation as similar to Germany after the 30 Years' War. As part of a systemic plan to maintain stability, Edo society was an elaborate social structure in which everybody knew their place and level of prestige. At the top were the emperor and court nobility, invincible in prestige but weak in power. Next came the shogun, daimyos, and layers of feudal lords. A social order called the Four Divisions of Society was adapted to stabilize the country composed of samurai, farming peasants, artisans, and merchants. The classes were not arranged by wealth or capital, but by what philosophers described as their moral purity. Peasants, who made up 80% of the population, were forbidden to engage in non-agricultural activities so as to ensure a stable and continuing source of income for those in positions of authority. Harsh penalties, including crucifixion, beheading, and death by boiling, were decreed for the most minor offenses. Taxes were a nightmare. The 300 daimyo set their own tax rates and only collected payments in goods such as rice. Taxes were about a 40% cut, and common people had to go through multiple famines while their money paid for the samurai to do kendo and write poetry. During the 19th century, Japan suffered through a deprivation known as the tempo famine, caused by long winters and wet summer crops such as rice, wheat, barley, and bamboo shoots to grow less than a third of the average harvest for several years. This famine and the arrival of a certain group of people sparked several years of change, war, and growth in Japan.
Breaking news, we have a very special guest with us here today on Industrial Japan News. I managed to snag an exclusive interview with a young lad. Let me introduce you to the great son of Kome. Alright, hello Meiji.
Konnichiwa.
So the people love you. They love your confident, ambitious attitude. But rarely do you talk about yourself. They're dying to know personally. What do you like to do during your free time?
Well, first of all, I'm extremely thankful that you and our citizens see me that way. I'm here in Japan trying to make not only the country better for me and for you, but also all the citizens and their neighbors and their neighbors and their neighbors.
In my free time, I love to embrace Western food and cooking styles. Tempura is my favorite, and although I'm the future emperor of Japan, I'm only 13. I really like to study at school. My two favorite languages are German and French. And shout out to my tutor, Kido Takayoshi.
That's great to hear. You're an incredibly talented young man. But I want to know, once you're emperor, what do you plan to do, and how will you respond to the Tokugawa government if they reject your proposal to reform?
I want to replace our corrupt feudal system with a completely new political and social system. I also will strive to build and create a westernized industrial economy. Western guns and power and government are far superior to our Eastern government, power, and guns. Japan can't keep rejecting change. We're not powerful enough to ignore these Western people, so why not embrace them? Why not implement their ideas and technologies into our own culture? I wish to modernize our country, and I know some traditional citizens are angry about it, but if we want to continue living peacefully, then change is our best option.
The ruling shogun at the time, Tokugawa Inari, and his corrupt office officials refused to help feed the impoverished residents of the country. This decision led to even more distaste towards Japan's shogunate leaders, since the people had already begun to view the leadership as incompetent and untrustworthy, and social tensions began to rise. In 1852, to the shock of the Tokugawa government, Americans arrived on the Bay of Edo to discuss potential trade and possible release of imprisoned whalers. Being no longer able to isolate themselves, Japan signed the Treaty of Kanagawa for peace with the Americans. The treaty evidently upset many Japanese inhabitants, as it opposed Japan's sacred principle of isolation, and thus when the Americans returned to be greeted by open hostility by the Japanese, their guns and superior technology made short work of Japan's ancient military power. Japan's Tokugawa government was in shambles. Many people were angry at the inability of Japan's mighty emperor, but mainly shogun, to defend Japan from outside threat. And many nationalist movements, such as the Satchel Alliance, which rejected the shogunate's current power and supported the use of Western weapons, began to dangerously crawl into prominence. Emperor Meiji, son of Emperor Kome, became enthroned in 1867, and he strived to restore the power to non-isolationist shogun and reform Japan as a country. The Satchel Alliance greatly influenced the young 13-year-old Emperor Meiji to overthrow the Tokugawa government, and he proceeded to invite the French to modernize Japan's army and the British to upgrade the navy.
The general public adored Emperor Meiji as he looked to bring back the imperialism of the emperor's powers that were previously overcast by shogun and daimyo power. However, the Tokugawa government was not eager to step down, and the Boshin Civil War between the shogunate forces and the Satchel Alliance soon erupted.
After a short yet gruesome 2 years of the Boshin Civil War, Tokugawa shogunate forces were eventually defeated and Emperor Meiji took effective power, ending the shogun dynasty and unifying Japan under one imperialistic rule. The end of the civil war in 1868 marked the start of the restoration and the beginning of modern Japan. The first order of business was to relocate the imperial court in Kyoto to Edo, which was renamed Tokyo, and became the new capital. Christianity was legalized, and Neo-Confucianism, as the country's official religion, was overturned. Railways and telegraph offices were built with the help of British entrepreneurs. Foreign advisors were hired in a policy called the Oyatoi Gagokujin. They provided help towards many fields of sciences and innovations such as math, military technology, medicine, and consumer products. A universal education system was set up, and Japan developed modern industries and institutions. Relying on these foreign advisors was only a temporary solution, so Emperor Meiji sent hundreds of young Japanese students to foreign countries in order to study and bring back valuable knowledge of technology and sciences. Japan expanded its sovereignty over new territories such as the Okinawa Prefecture. Economic growth and state-owned enterprises thrived because of the new Bank of Japan established. An official constitution was adopted in 1889, providing Japan with an elected house. Japan was catching up to European countries and modernizing at one of the fastest rates seen by any empire. And of course, this was met by traditionalist disagreements. Modern Japan was no longer a place for the outdated samurai, and small samurai revolts were launched by traditionalist factions, nonetheless crushed by the modern imperialist army. Despite the lack of impact these traditionalist factions had on Japan's development, it hinted at an unnoticeable yet growing frustration at the emperor's modernizing Japan that would soon become prevalent in later years.
We interrupt our program to bring you this important message.
Alright, Nick, you got this. I got this spring water from the highest quality springs you've ever seen. You're gonna need everything you can get to beat him. Don't worry, I found this preacher for when he died. Look, he's got the highest rated Yelp reviews. And all the bros are here to watch it.
Oh boy, is it funeral day?
Sure is, and I brought my favorite casket.
I just don't think I should be celebrating death. Ever since I was a kid, my parents would tell me, don't do that.
Dude, everyone dies. It's fine.
My parents would kill me.
Nick, you won't regret your choice. Funerals are in right now.
Jesus Christ, that's tart. Where do you guys keep the cream and sugar? What's that he's drinking over there?
Why would the water he's drinking matter in any context?
Yo!
Damn!
The First Sino-Japan War, lasting from July 1894 to April 1895, was a conflict between the Qing Dynasty and the Empire of Japan over the occupation of Korea. The end of the First Sino-Japan War marked the beginning of tyranny and Japanese imperialism, and a shift from reformation to absolute domination. During the time of the Meiji Restoration, the Qing Dynasty also started to go through a social and political reform, albeit far less successful than Japan's. With this head start in technology, ideas, and most importantly weapons, Japan sought to expand its influence and power. Unfortunately for the Ryukyu Kingdom, a state of China, Japan chose to invade and integrate them in 1872. Soon after, Japan set its eyes on Korea. When a gunboat was shot at by Korea, Japan took the opportunity to create an unequal treaty as compensation, unfairly forcing Japan's influence and gaining privileges to trade, as well as territorial rights. Japan also sent a Japanese military attaché to train Korean soldiers in a Western modernized way. Keep in mind that this was all still under the rule and decision of Emperor Meiji, as he passed away later in 1912. While training, a Japanese military supervisor was assassinated by a traditionalist band of Koreans, drawing more negative attention to Korea. Japan immediately dispatched forces, which alarmed the Qing Dynasty enough to send their own troops in case of battle. Both entering Korea, China's troops made it first and put down the uprising. Now under a partial Chinese rule and Chinese occupation, but still under the Treaty of Japan, the Chinese forcibly seized control over Korea. This act of defiance by China to the Empire of Japan greatly upset them, and Japan prepared themselves for potential conflict. In 1884, Japanese reformists attempted a coup, which failed due to Chinese forces, who then killed reformists and all Japanese that were sympathetic to the cause. In response, the Japanese dispatched 7 warships. This conflict was ultimately settled in the Convention of Tientsin in 1885, in which it was agreed that both Japan and China would withdraw all troops from Korea and would notify each other of their troops if they ever wanted to send personnel into Korea. Followed by an incident in Nagasaki in 1886, where there was a riot of Chinese sailors occupying Nagasaki, the conflict was boiling.
What in tarnation? What are all these people rioting for?
Change.
Change for what?
I don't know, but I'm angry. Here's your sign.
In 1894, Korea suffered a massive peasant uprising and a disastrous famine swept across the country. This result was called the Donghak Rebellion. Needing help, the Korean government called for assistance from China, who dispatched 3,000 troops to go to Korea. Viewing this mobilization as a violation to their established agreement, Japan sent 5,000 troops to Korea. Passing the point of no return, a fight broke out, now called the Battle of Pungdo. From then on, both Japan and China officially declared war on January 8, 1894. Oh! Pointing their eyes to Pyongyang, the last Chinese stronghold, the Japanese sent thousands of soldiers as reinforcements who marched north towards the stronghold. In September 1894, the Japanese attacked in the war's second major and most important land battle called the Battle of Pyongyang. Under heavy artillery fire, the Chinese had to surrender to the Japanese army and move back to the border of China and Korea. This effectively was the surrendering of the Korean Peninsula to the Japanese. Many lands all around Asia became occupied by Japanese forces, and with them, their imperialism followed. Japan sought to expand its influence, no longer content with being an enclosed country and living in isolation. As a reward for Japan winning against China, they gained possession of Taiwan. Japan forced all Taiwanese residents to learn Japanese and their culture. This came at the cost of suppressing and censoring almost all of Taiwan's own ways of life and the Chinese language. As World War II started, Taiwan became known as an unsinkable aircraft carrier and was crucial in Japan's expansion into the Philippines. Many Taiwanese even joined the Japanese army, and more than 30,000 were killed in combat.
This shift in goals from reforming themselves to willingly going to war to expanding power caused Japan's imperialism to take a more supremacist perspective. Although Japan didn't view their race as superior to others, the imperial government proved that they were a major world power.
Finally, the culmination of the Japanese imperialistic ways led to a clear and devastating show of the suffering brought on by imperialism. After the fall of Shanghai, China was unable to hold back the unrelenting force of the Japanese armies. Japan occupied Nanking in one of the most devastating occupations in modern history. Historians estimate that over 300,000 people were killed and 80,000 people raped. Videos taken by John McGee provide some of the lone footage taken of these atrocities.
We interrupt our program to bring you this important message.
Nukes, weapons of mass destruction that have been recently introduced by nuclear physicists around the world. These inventions of the devil contain power so immense that it would surely spell the world's end if they fell into the wrong hands.
I'm J. Robert Oppenheimer, here to present to you the Manhattan Project and its progress so far. You see, nukes tend to cause a lot of death. Death equals fewer people equals less money equals less money. Is all this so far clear to you?
Sure, but you've only talked about potential atrocities from enemy bombings. How can we trust our own country when we're responsible for these weapons?
My fellow American, I would like to appreciate the quality of your question. However, it is irrelevant. Our company products are nukes. Trust that, they're just very big bombs involving uranium matter.
But how will the introduction of nukes affect our political stability? Who will have access and control over these crucial weapons? Will the choice be put on only our president?
Okay, that is enough talking. Somebody please get this stupid offset and get rid of this filter too.
God, I hate this job.
Our country's nukes have been repeatedly tested to kill the greatest amount of enemies in the most efficient and humane way possible. Test drops have been dropped in Canada, since we don't think anybody's going to be there, and we want to demonstrate the humanity to some bears.
It's so cold in Canada right now.
Nah, it's always winter here, man.
Is that a Seahawks beanie? A Sounders scarf? I wonder what the Americans are doing.
Look up at the sky. What's that in the air?
What did they just drop on us?
Don't worry, it's probably just some geese. Doesn't concern us.
Nukes may cause side effects such as nausea and vomiting, diarrhea, headache, fever, dizziness and disorientation, weakness and fatigue, hair loss, blood vomit, infections, low blood pressure, and death.
In December 1941, the entirety of the Japanese naval fleet sailed across the Pacific Ocean to attack, at the time, an unknown enemy. While on the seas, the crewmates were clueless as who and what Emperor Hirohito sent them to bombard. Unlike these people, we know now that these ships were sailing across the Pacific Ocean to surprise attack the United States of America, who were 10 times more powerful and richer than Japan. The Japanese Navy had an estimated 50% chance of success at their mission, and it was a grand but pipe dream proposal by General Yamamoto, meant to be a crude awakening for the United States to join the war.
Battleships were so deeply entrenched in the minds of Americans as a symbol of naval power, and by shattering their battle fleet, General Yamamoto thought that their fleet along with their morale would be crushed. Japan's plan was to ambush the naval base on the tropical island of Oahu. This would heavily delay the United States Navy's entry into the war and giving Japan more strategic head start.
Their main intentions were to sink and damage the US naval fleet so that they could have an easier time expanding into the West without American intervention. Despite the fact that the strike force, the Kido Butai, embarked at least 411 aircraft for the operation, making the most powerful naval force in the Pacific, the attack remained a risky undertaking. The first Japanese dive bomber appeared over Pearl Harbor at 7:55 a.m. It was part of the first wave of nearly 200 aircraft, including torpedo planes, bombers, and fighters. Due to Walter Short's anti-sabotage measures, the US military aircraft were packed tightly together at the Naval Air Station on Ford Island and adjoining Wheeler and Hickam Fields, and many were destroyed on ground by Japanese strafing. At Wheeler Field in particular, the destruction was fearful. Of the 126 planes on the ground, 42 were totally destroyed, 41 were damaged, which only left 43 fit for service. Only 6 US planes got into the air to repel attackers in this first assault. In total, more than 180 aircraft were destroyed. At 8:50 a.m., the second wave of attacks began and it inflicts heavy damage. The battleships USS Nevada has sustained a torpedo hit during the first wave, but its position at the end of Battleship Row allowed for greater freedom of action than other capital ships. It was attempting to get underway when the second wave hit. It was struck by 7 or 8 bombs and was grounded at the head of the channel. The battleship USS Pennsylvania was set ablaze by bombs, and 2 destroyers near it were reduced to wrecks. The US destroyer, USS Shaw, was split into 2 by a great explosion. Shortly after, 9 a.m., the Japanese withdrew. Although brief, many ships were damaged. The list of hit battleships consists of the USS California, the USS West Virginia, USS Cassin, USS Downs, USS Ogla, USS Oklahoma, and the USS Arizona. But 3 months, half of the ships thought to be destroyed are returned to action. Eventually, all but 3 of the ships are repaired and returned to the battle. With the aggressive expansion into China, Japan started a quest for war a decade before it expanded into a worldwide conflict. The imperialist actions led to the rise of Japanese expansion and power. Hirohito was the Emperor of Japan from 1926 until his death in 1989. He controlled Japan throughout the entirety of World War II and played an active role in attacking Japan's Asian neighbors and the surprise assault on Pearl Harbor. Since the Meiji period, Japan has been a constitutional monarchy. However, the name did not obscure from the fact that Japan's form of government was more akin to the aristocratic oligarchy. Although the bombing of Pearl Harbor gave Hirohito temporary dominance, Japan failed to destroy the oil storage facilities on the island as well as the carriers located off the island on the day. In December 1940, Japan signed a tripartite pact with Nazi Germany and Fascist Italy, in which they agreed to assist one another should any of them have been attacked by a country not involved in the war. Japan sent troops to occupy French Indochina in the same month, and the United States responded with economic sanctions, which caused the embargo on oil and steel. A little over a year later, Hirohito consented to the decision of his government to battle the Americans, thus leading to the eventual bombing of Pearl Harbor.
Japan occupied the Dutch East Indies, British Singapore, New Guinea, the Philippines, and some other locations in the Southeast Asia and Pacific. But the Battle of Midway in 1942 and the Battle of the Guadalcanal, Japan's expansion was completely stopped. Japan's military leaders knew their unlikely victory, and yet didn't stop fighting until the bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki.
On August 6, 1945, the first uranium bomb, nicknamed Little Boy, dropped on the city of Hiroshima. It had an explosive yield equal to 15,000 tons of TNT and raised and burned around 70% of all buildings, causing an estimated 140,000 people to die by the end of 1945, along with increased rates of cancer and chronic disease among the survivors. A slightly larger plutonium bomb exploded over Nagasaki 3 days later, nicknamed Fat Man, which killed 74,000 people by the end of 1945. Hirohito's leadership was truly put to the test after the new games. Japan needed their leader, their emperor, to say something. 2 days after Nagasaki's destruction, the emperor admitted that the war could not continue. But it wasn't until the Soviet Union's entrance into the war that Japan formally surrendered.
With Japan's defeat, the political parties which had suspended activities during the war reemerged, and they resumed their active roles. The Japanese Socialist Party, the Japanese Liberal Party, the Japanese Progressive Party, and the Japanese Cooperative Party were formed one after the other. The Japanese Communist Party was also legalized. Japan's initial post-war election, held in April 1946, saw women exercise their franchise for the first time. Women finally had the right to vote as part of a unionization effort by the US. With the removal of monopolistic industrial control, it allowed for a more capitalist society to take hold.
This allowed everyday citizens to rise up in the world regardless of their birth. The United States' decision essentially removed the class hierarchy previously enforced since the Edo period. The remains of an imperialist country were now abolished, and Japan's government was established as a parliamentary democracy. Stay with-